Welcome to you all. For the Scientific Council for Government Policy, the WRR, in providing scientific advice over all policy domains, one question is always central: how to serve welfare and well-being of all people in local communities, nationally, and in international contexts. Accordingly, in a time in which many people look for new societal anchors in situations of experience uncertainty, this year's lecture explores precariousness as observed in a variety of social and policy domains. Special attention is paid today to its health implications. First, because health seems to be an insufficiently recognized aspect of precariousness. And second, obviously, because health consistently belongs to the issues people care for the most and care about the most. Professor Martin McKee will give us a lot more insight in this area shortly in a broad societal approach. In this context, biomedical concepts of health, while indispensable, of course, will not suffice. At the other hand, all too comprehensive health concepts may miss opportunities for targeted policymaking. And we look forward to have a reflection on this by Beatrice Haverkamp, PhD scholar at Wageningen University in philosophy. When it comes to the challenges that precariousness poses to policymaking, we welcome our panel with Ingrid van Engelshoven and Jan-Antonie Bruin, who will be later introduced by our panel chair, Godfried Engbersen. While they are also politicians, as we all know, we have asked them to contribute as professionals today, professionals in the craft of urban and national policymaking. And they will exchange views with Martin McKee in a discussion led by, as I said, Council Member Godfried Engbersen, Professor of Sociology. And we anticipate to also have some opportunity for questions from the audience. A bit more introduction now of our keynote speaker, Martin McKee, and his really amazing oeuvre and activity. Born in Belfast, Martin was trained in internal medicine and public health. He is professor of European public health at the London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine and founder of the European Centre on Health of Societies in Transition. He is also research director of the European Observatory on Health Systems and Policies, and he's president of the European Public Health Association. He's a member of the esteemed US Institute of Medicine, holds many honorary doctorates and professorships all over the world, and was awarded various prestigious prizes, such as the Donabedian International Award for Outstanding Contributions to Healthcare. Not enough wall space anymore, as you said once, Martin. Martin has authored enviably numerous research papers on health and health policy, with a particular focus on countries undergoing political and social transition. Of the many books he published, I just mentioned two: Human Resources for Health in Europe, and the contribution of health to the economy of the European Union. He also contributes a lot to the public debate, for example, in the Financial Times and the Guardian, on issues like health systems, health inequalities, and the Brexit, being a commander of the Order of the British Empire. Noblesse oblige, I would say. The Lancet, world-leading journal in the field of medicine and health, honored Martin McKee as champion of public health in Europe. And the British Medical Journal wrote, "Martin McKee is an inescapable presence to anybody with even a fleeting interest in public health. We didn't escape from him either. For the next 45 minutes, the floor is to Martin McKee, and please turn off all other noises.
Right, thank you very much. How can I live up to that introduction? So let me just set the clock running. I want to begin by thanking the Scientific Council for Government Policy for asking me to give this very prestigious lecture. And it's a particular pleasure to see so many colleagues that I've worked with over the years in the audience today. One of the greatest achievements of post-war Western Europe was to provide security for its people. We had collective security from external threats in the form of NATO, but we also had security from internal threats, and these internal threats were, these internal threats were summarized in the United Kingdom by William Beveridge as the five giant evils of society: want, disease, ignorance, squalor, and idleness. And it was the struggle against these giants that was the basis of the post-war welfare state in the United Kingdom. The desire for security among politicians and the population at that time in the post-war period was really quite understandable. People had lived through the Depression of the 1930s and they'd lived through the Second World War. And many had direct personal experience of uncertainty. And just to take one example, we take William Dries, who served four terms as Dutch Prime Minister in the 1940s and the 1950s. At the outset of the war, as you all know, he was imprisoned in Buchenwald and released after a year. He worked with clandestine organizations providing support for the poor, and especially those in the underground and those who lacked links to some of the religious charities that had retained support from the collaborationist administration. He was all too aware of the meaning of insecurity, including the insecurity of life itself. After the liberation, as you all know, he became Minister of Social Affairs, and he created a new system of old age pensions using emergency provisions to do so. And in this way, he greatly increased the role of the Dutch state in providing social assistance. But he was not unique. Across Europe, politicians from the right and from the left were establishing new systems that would provide security for their populations. There was a political consensus. So by the late 1950s, Europe's leaders, who had learned the lessons of the 1930s and the 1940s, were in power, and they were determined not to repeat the many mistakes of the past. The state and the employers took on risks that had once been borne by individuals and their families. And the resulting security allowed people to look to the future with confidence, contributing to marked improvements in health and well-being. And I stress, this was based on a political consensus right across the spectrum. But memories fade. The 1980s were a time of change, at least in the English-speaking world. Ronald Reagan became President of the United States. Margaret Thatcher became the British Prime Minister, and together they gave their names to a new philosophy characterized by shrinkage of the size of the state, with privatization of state-owned enterprises and retrenchment of the welfare state. Here in the Netherlands, Ruud Lubbers was pursuing similar policies. We were all told that the idea of a job for life was at an end. We were on our own, with Thatcher famously declaring that there is no such thing as society. But even then, there was a limit. Even Thatcher retained many of the elements of the welfare state, even, as we now know, somewhat reluctantly. And people still retained some degree of employment protection. It was much later that things really did change. And the year was 2008, and the cause was a sequence of events far away. Banks in the United States had accumulated vast cash reserves, and they needed to do something with them. The ingenuity of the bankers knew no bounds. High salaries attracted a new generation with a new set of skills into the financial services sector. And tragically, as we now know, many of that new generation had little, if any, idea about what they were doing. We had been warned. The movie The Wolf of Wall Street revealed a situation in which decisions were fueled by liberal amounts of cocaine, and that is another area where we could have some medical evaluation, the effect of cocaine on risk-taking in Manhattan and in London. Well, I don't need to tell you what happened. You know, and hopefully many of you have seen the other movie which explains all of this, and that is The Big Short, which tells the story far better than I could ever manage. But the bottom line to all of this was that governments gave a very large amount of our money to save the banks, what we now call welfare for Wall Street, leaving none for the ordinary people. Many of those ordinary people had been coping up until then, but only just. The situation got much worse when their employers started laying people off. Unemployment rose rapidly. And although it's now falling again in many countries, including the Netherlands, this placed a huge burden on social protection systems, just at a time when government resources were scarce. So the obvious answer was to cut welfare budgets. And in fact, while all countries did all cut spending, not all actually cut their welfare budgets. There were choices to be made. And as we showed in one paper, governments differed in what they cut. And they had other choices too. They could raise taxes, especially those on income and capital gains that would impact most on the rich, including the bankers who had been the beneficiaries of their largesse. But in many countries, those who had enjoyed some degree of job security lost it. Now, most of those who lost jobs did ultimately find new ones. But when they did, the new ones were often very different. There was no more certainty that when you went to work on a Monday morning, you would be paid to work until a Friday evening. The term zero hours contract entered the vocabulary in some countries. Now, I know that this is still not a significant issue here in the Netherlands because of your labor laws, so maybe I'd better explain it. And the easiest way in which I can do so is to take the text from a zero hours contract. And if you do go to the UK and you buy a sandwich in the subway chain, this is what the people who serve you will have signed up to. They must agree that the company has no duty to provide you with work. Your hours of work are not predetermined and will be notified to you on a weekly basis, as soon as is reasonably practical in advance by your store manager, which might only be an hour in advance. The company has the right to require you to work varied or extended hours from time to time. And there has been a massive increase in contracts such as this in the United Kingdom. Now, flexible working hours are attractive to some people. Mothers returning to the labor market, for example, as their children grow up. I should say parents, because it should be both. But the difference is that these people want to do so by choice and want to have some control over their working arrangements. What we are now seeing is a new class of workers, a group of workers who do not have that control and whose lives are dominated by what we might call precariousness. Now, French writers have been studying the nature of work for many years, had recognized that there was a group within the population whose lives could be characterized as precariousness, and they invoked the concept of précarité d'emploi. In France, this was seen as something to be countered by politicians of both the right, like Jacques Chirac, and the left, by François Hollande. Both made comments that were highly critical of the growth of precariousness and tried to do something about it. And crucially, precariousness was not the same as poverty. Many of the people whose lives were precarious were also poor. But precariousness included other concepts such as low skills, harsh working conditions, and insecurity. Work that involved very few rewards for actually engaging in it. Of course, the literature in precariousness was largely at that time written in French, so it did not cross the channel. In England, it was only in 2013 that precariousness actually entered the popular consciousness, and it did so with the publication of the Great British Class Survey. And this identified a number of groups. It identified seven contemporary classes, which replaced the conventional ones that we talked about in terms of social classes, starting with the elite and going all the way down to the precariat at the bottom. And the writer Guy Standing then popularized this term in a widely read book so that it came into the public imagination. Now, concerns about precariousness have become really quite widespread in the United Kingdom, and you just need to pick up a newspaper like The Guardian. And if you look at this from a few weeks ago, you can see that a fifth of Britons are now thought to be at risk of precariousness. And The Guardian has had a series of these articles where it's looked at groups that you might not think of as insecure, like university lecturers, for example, a growing number of whom are on 0 hours contracts. So what I now want to do is to look a little bit at those in the population who are the precariat, or who at least have become so. And I want to preface my comments by saying a little bit about where I have come from, because my work and my research started off in the 1990s by looking at the health effects of the political, economic, and social transition in Eastern Europe following the collapse of communism. And at that time, I and my colleagues came to recognize the important factors that made individuals and societies more vulnerable or more resilient. And in fact, we were being drawn into the literature on precariousness without realizing it. We at that time were really quite unaware of the discussions that had been going on in the French literature on precariousness. And of course, this in part also reflected the dominance of related concepts like social inequalities among the community that we inhabited. But you can see that there is a problem frequently of translating between disciplines and between languages. But when we did recognize this literature and precariousness, we began to feel a little bit like Molière's Monsieur Jourdan in Le Bourgeois Gentilhomme, who, as you will remember, said, "Good heavens, for more than 40 years I have been speaking prose without knowing it." Well, we can see that precariousness is a complex, multifaceted concept from some of the ways in which it's been described. And we can look at that, we can see how it's been talked about as the spread of greater labour market flexibility, greater job insecurity, a greater fragility in relationships and a weakening of the formal provision of social welfare. The concepts of precariousness, precarious housing and precarious employment make direct reference to the marginal position of many households. Our precarious employment is uncertain, unpredictable, and risky from the point of view of the worker, not from the point of view of the employer. Precariousness in relation to work refers to all forms of insecure, contingent, flexible work, from illegalized, casualized, and temporary employment to home working, piece working, and freelancing. So there are many varying definitions and terminology that have been used. But what all of these have in common is that those whose lives are precarious face uncertainty in several areas, including employment, income, and housing. It's been linked to what has been described as the privatization of risk. Now, politicians often see this as a good thing. They frame it as giving individuals back control. And of course, it has intuitive appeal. But it can equally be interpreted as telling people that they're on their own. And a widely mocked example in the UK is David Cameron's Big Society initiative. Essentially, the state will be dismantled. I think these slides are moving on a little bit without me necessarily touching anything. So clearly, creating a degree of precariousness for me. It's good to experience what you're talking about. We need to understand a little bit. We need to understand a little bit more about precariousness, and we can do so in terms of how it is actually used in reality. And for this, we can turn to the UNDP 2014 Human Development Report, and it describes a widespread sense of precariousness in the world today, in livelihoods, in personal security, in the environment, and in global politics. This was written in 2014. Little did they know what would be happening 2 years later. And although in this report, precariousness is not actually defined, When you read through the report, you find many examples of how the term precarious or precariousness is used to describe the circumstances in which many people live, including informal employment, but also the threat of conflict, natural disasters, the lack of civil, economic, and social rights, and exposures to food price hikes, this issue of uncertainty, insecurity. Now, we can look in a little bit more detail. Those whose lives are precarious, and this may be rendered vulnerable. And the UNDP report asks three questions to help to understand vulnerability. It asks, who is vulnerable? To what? And why? So, for example, it tells us that the poor, informal workers, and those who are socially excluded are vulnerable to economic and health shocks. But whole communities may be vulnerable to conflict and civil unrest because of low social cohesion, unresponsive institutions, and poor governance. So we have precariousness, we have vulnerability, and we have another term, resilience. And this is used in different ways in different disciplines. It's one that we've looked at a lot in systematic reviews and elsewhere. But we can here think of it in terms of social resilience, the capacity of individuals or groups to secure favorable outcomes under new circumstances, constantly changing circumstances, and if need be, by new means. Same idea is also captured as the dynamic ability of individuals and communities and entire societies to adapt positively to shocks. And haven't we had a lot of shocks in the last few years? It's important to note, however, that precariousness can cut across traditional classifications of social protection or class. Many of us here, and Johan Mackenbach is in the audience and others, have done tremendous work in terms of looking at social class, the social inequalities in health. But here we're seeing something new. Individuals can be in a state of precariousness even if they are well-educated and in employment, like the example of university lecturers I mentioned earlier. And of course, those people in conventional sociology, social epidemiology would be considered as being in a favorable situation. But the problem is that the people at the bottom of the pile, they are particularly vulnerable because they have no assets to fall back on. Now, one contemporary example, which I'm particularly familiar with in my role as medical director at the London School of Hygiene, is that of junior doctors in the British National Health Service. And in fact, we've been talking over the last few days about a study which needs to be done, which is, why is the morale of doctors in the Netherlands still relatively good, whereas in the UK it is at rock bottom? And this is a group that would seem to be seen to be exceptionally privileged in terms of income and in terms of job security. But the reality of it is that this is a group now who, from one week to the next, may have no idea what hours they will be working. And from one year to the next, will have no idea of what part of the country they will be sent to. And this has rendered this group of people, it rendered it almost impossible for anyone with family responsibilities to juggle their multiple commitments. And as I say, morale is now at rock bottom. Rates of burnout are increasing rapidly, and very large numbers are leaving the profession. When I trained in internal medicine, more than 90% of people finishing their basic training, their 2 years postgraduation, would move on to specialist training. That figure is now 52%. What's really important is that the institutions of society, and in particular government, can protect those whose lives are precariousness. And they can do this by both reducing the risk of a shock and by mitigating its effects if it should occur, by creating safety nets. Many people have noted how a strong welfare state protects workers from the consequences of employment precariousness, for example. Now, we can look at this by thinking about how job loss is associated with worse mental health and, in some cases, suicide. We've been particularly interested in the impact of the Great Recession following 2008, and we've documented in detail how suicides have been increasing. But what else do we know? Well, we looked at the impact of job loss and mental health among people in Greece in 2009, before the worst of the austerity packages were introduced, and then we looked again in 2011 when it was hitting hard. And what became clear that although, of course, job loss was associated with deteriorating mental health, this is entirely what you would expect, What we also found was that the impact of job loss on mental health was much greater in the context of austerity. So there were a whole lot of other things that were happening. There was an increased probability of losing your job, but the impact of losing your job was much greater because of the economic situation. Now, Theresa May, the British Prime Minister, has made much of her desire to help those that she describes as just about managing, the so-called jams. And one of the reasons that many people are only just managing is that they're paid very little. And this means that if misfortune should befall them, they have very few, if any, financial resources to fall back on. But some years ago, the situation was even worse because we had no minimum wage. Now, of course, I'm well aware that even now that we do have one, there are many employers who get around it. And those in irregular employment that I've already mentioned, such as Uber drivers and others, have been effectively excluded from this, although fortunately we have had a recent court ruling that has changed that. But the question that you might ask is that for the very low paid, can a pay rise of a few pounds or a few pennies even actually make that much of a difference? Well, we were able to look at this. We looked at the introduction of the minimum wage in 1999 as a natural experiment. We used longitudinal data to track three groups of people. And the first were those who were below the threshold for the minimum wage and who saw an increase in their income. It wasn't a large increase, it was a very small increase. And second, there were those who were just above it, and so they had no benefit from the introduction of the new policy. And then there were some who were below it but stayed below it because it was inadequately enforced. And what we found was that there was a significant improvement in mental health, but only for those whose incomes increased by a few pennies. It was a very small increase, but what we found was that the impact, the magnitude of the change that they experienced was considerable, and it equated to what you would have found if you had put them on antidepressants. So it suggests that for people whose lives are precarious, a very small change can make a very big difference. Now, what I've described falls into the category that the French writers would have described as the précarité d'emploi. But there's also précarité de travail, or precarity of work, precariousness of work. And we've been looking at the epidemic of workplace suicides in France, where increasing numbers of employees have chosen to kill themselves in the face of the extreme pressures they're facing at work. Suicides there have affected a wide range of companies and sectors: postal services, car manufacturing, telecommunications, electricity and gas, the banks, supermarkets, research centres and call centres. In a number of cases, these individuals have left letters which were subsequently published in the press, which explicitly, in terms, blame the work or the conditions at their work as the cause of their actions. Others have decided to kill themselves in highly visible or symbolic ways. For example, returning to work from sick leave to take their own lives, hanging themselves in their own offices to make clear the connection between their suicide and their work. Now, in July 2016, Paris prosecutors announced that the former chief executive of the telecoms provider France Telecom, now rebranded as Orange, and six senior managers may face criminal charges in relation to suicide among their employees. And it follows an earlier case in which a French court of appeal found the car manufacturer Renault guilty of gross negligence with regard to three suicides at the company. But at least the French government has recognized that this is a problem, because in France, any suicide at work is considered work-related until proven otherwise. And suicides at work are investigated as work-related if any family member can show evidence suggesting a link. But there's a difference in the United Kingdom. And what we see there is that even those suicides that are committed in the workplace are presumed to be an individual and voluntary act. And the relevant legislation specifically excludes them. It states that all deaths to workers and non-workers, with the exception of suicides, must be reported if they arise from a work-related accident. We can look beyond employment and income. Many other people feel precarious because they may have nowhere to live. For consistency with the French terminology, we could call this the précarité de logement. And we realized that this was a problem for the first time when we looked at evidence from Spain at the early stages of the financial crisis. We were fortunate to have access to data from several thousand patients attending primary care centers in 2006-07 and 2010-11, before and during the economic crisis. All of these patients completed a standardized instrument designed to diagnose mental disorders. And we were able to show that there was a significant increase in mental illness after adjusting for the socio-demographic confounders. And in particular, there were large increases in depression, anxiety, and alcohol-related disorders. Now, as we might expect, job loss was a major factor. But so was getting into housing arrears or the threat of eviction, independent of employment status. Of course, that study had a number of limitations. It was based in two cross-sectional surveys, so we were not following up the same individuals. And we also had relatively limited information about the circumstances of the respondents. So at the time, this was really all that we could do. There were very few data following up individuals during the period of the crisis, at least data available to us. But by about 2014, well into the crisis, this changed. And data from the EU Survey of Income and Living Conditions became available for the early years of the crisis. It didn't have many questions on health, but there were some, so there was much more that we could do. So we stayed with housing in another study, and we identified all respondents from the then 27 EU member states who had no housing arrears in 2008, and we followed them up till 2010. And we found that those transitioning into arrears experienced a deterioration in their mental health, but only if they were renting accommodation. Those who owned their accommodation experienced no deterioration after we adjusted for other factors. So crucially, the event of falling into rent arrears was independent of and was greater than job loss. Once again, we found that the effect varied among countries. Policies matter. And some, for whatever reason, some countries, people were relatively protected. In others, such as Belgium and Austria and Italy, the effect was quite substantial. Well, we took advantage of a natural experiment in the UK to look a little bit closer at housing. And, and this was from April 2011, when the government reduced its financial support for low-income persons who were renting in the private sector. And the impact was really quite substantial. Those who were receiving benefit, housing benefit, were losing about €1,500 a year. And we compared mental health problems among those receiving housing benefit, who would suffer a loss, and those who did not receive benefit, who would be unaffected. Now, of course, given that this was in the midst of the economic crisis, it was unsurprising that even those who were spared the cuts experienced some worsening in mental health. But the change was several times larger among those whose benefits were cut. Now, as a public health researcher, I find myself constantly looking upstream to ascertain the causes of the causes. Why were some people experiencing housing problems and others were not? Now, of course, there are many individual factors, but are there any elements of government policy that can play a role? Are there any aspects of policy that place people in situations that are precarious in some areas rather than others? Well, to answer this question, we looked at variations in homelessness claims across England. And we wanted to explain the variations between 2004 and 2012. As we expected, we found that reductions in economic activity in a local area were important because that led to job losses and reductions in income. The lower spending impacted on local shops and service providers. But homelessness was also clearly associated with reductions in welfare spending and, as you might expect, cuts to housing services and so on, but also spending on social care and income support for older people who we were told had been relatively protected. Now, the final area where I want to look at precariousness is the ability to feed oneself and one's family, which we might call, we keep with the French, precarité de la sécurité alimentaire. We have seen a remarkable increase in the supply, the number of food banks in the United Kingdom. And So I'll come back to that in a minute. But we were interested in what was happening across Europe, and we used data from 21 countries, and we found that food insecurity had increased between 2004 and 2012. And we could show, when we looked at the natural experiments across Europe, this was clearly associated with both job loss and with income reduction. People were experiencing food insecurity on a level not seen in recent decades. The growth of food banks in the United Kingdom, of course, has been very controversial, and you may have seen coverage in the newspapers of this. What were the reasons for this? Well, we can ask the politicians, and the politicians were very clear about the reasons. They've attributed to people being unable to manage their finances or spending their money on alcohol and cigarettes. Because food is free, it's assumed that there's infinite demand. None of these people, even though they are welfare ministers, realize that if you want to use a food bank, you have to be referred by a doctor or a social worker. You can't just turn up. So we looked at this in a paper in the British Medical Journal. And what we found was that, in fact, the growth of food banks had followed the job losses, followed the cuts in welfare spending, and what were termed the benefit sanctions, an especially cruel measure which is exploited by staff and welfare officers to help them meet their targets to reduce the number of people on benefits. They typically pick on the most vulnerable, such as the blind or disabled, or give people appointments, people living in rural areas, appointments at times before public transport is operating, and this has been described in great detail in parliamentary inquiries. So we've looked at a number of areas of precariousness, precariousness in terms of income, in terms of housing, in terms of food security. Let me just pull all of this together so far. We've shown that the financial crisis and the subsequent imposition of austerity has impacted on people in many ways. An estimated 5 million European citizens lost their jobs between 2008 and 2010. Many others have experienced reductions in income. Many people have lost their homes, and if they haven't lost their homes, they've fallen into arrear. Although the data are not easily available, where we do have data, we can find that the numbers of homeless increased by about 15% between 2008 and 2010. Other people, shockingly, have gone without food. In all of these ways, people's lives have become more precarious. And as we've shown, this meant not only that they were at greater risk of misfortune, but if they are unfortunate that a disaster strikes, then the consequences are much worse than they were before. And of course, what we have described is only the tip of the iceberg. Many of those who have escaped these experiences live in constant fear of the future. Their jobs, their income, their housing may be secure for now, but for how much longer? They can still afford their homes. Will that continue? And if they have to move to get a new job, what will this mean for getting to work? Will they have to travel longer? Can they afford public transport? If you travel by train in the UK, you do not have an OV chip card where the fare is the same all the time. I envy you every time. I have my one, and it is a great asset compared to what we have to put up with, where you may need to book your train weeks in advance to know that you'll get there at an affordable cost. And what will a move mean for their children's schooling? So we in our research have only just scratched the surface of this problem. We have shown that even a very small change, such as a wage increase that most of us would not even notice, can make a big difference to mental health. And in contrast, we've shown that a cut in housing benefit can increase substantially the risk of mental illness. And we've also seen the indifference of politicians to the plight of those who are living on the edge. Clearly, there's an enormous research agenda for the future. Now, I hope that I've convinced you that we should be concerned about precariousness. I hope that I've shown how it impacts on health of some of the most vulnerable people in our societies. And as someone who's committed to improving health overall, but for especially for those whose health is worst, this surely has to be a matter of concern. But in the final part of my talk, I want to conclude by arguing that there's another reason why we as a society should be concerned about the growth and persistence of a section of the population who feel left behind in a world that for them is characterized by uncertainty. The word precariousness is related to the Latin precor, to beseech or to pray. Once, in the days, to quote Thomas Hobbes, life was nasty, brutish, and short, and those whose lives were most precarious were likely to turn to religion, although for the philosophers, you'll know there's some debate about Hobbes's religious views, although sensibly he kept them quiet at the time. Now, some people will still turn to religion, but at least in the 20th century, where there were times when for most of our lives, we knew that if you did look to the future, it would generally be better. Well, we were very interested to know what we could learn from the historical parallels. And we were interested to look at an earlier period of austerity. And of course, the earlier period we could look at was the Weimar Republic. And at that time, of course, we wanted to know if the rise in austerity had in any way contributed to the rise of National Socialism. This was also a period of great uncertainty, when unemployment rose steeply, when rampant inflation destroyed savings, and when many Germans, in search of a better life, emigrated to the New World. So what we did was to go through the archives and collect very detailed data, and we looked at voting patterns in the five Reichstag elections between 1928 and 1933. And we looked at a variety of measures of the economy. And this included measures of government spending and tax withheld from wages. We looked at hourly wages and economic output. And we were able to disaggregate this to very localized levels of geographical analysis. And we were able to map this onto the constituencies. And our analyses showed very clearly that there was an association between the depth of austerity and the rise in support for the National Socialists. Now, crucially, what we were seeing was not just a measure of impoverishment. In fact, the very poor, the people whose lives were hit hardest by job losses, were not turning to the Nazis, they were turning to the communists. It was those who were just above them in the pecking order who turned to the Nazis. These were the group that had something to lose and whose lives really were precarious. If you're right at the bottom, you may not be precarious because you can't get any worse. Many of the certainties that this group took for granted, such as jobs for life and improving living conditions, and whose children's prospects were better than their own, had vanished then, and they have vanished now. And we're seeing similar groups. We're seeing people who are looking around for someone to blame. And of course, nowadays, and there were analogies then, of course, I don't need to repeat, nowadays, they don't need to look very far. In the shops and in the streets and in the schools, they see people who are visibly different. And when politicians also point the finger of blame to those who look different, it is far, far too easy to accept this narrative. What they do not see, of course, is that those others are doing the jobs that they neither want to do or have the skills to do. So nowadays, we tend to forget that our healthcare systems manage only because we import skilled workers from the rest of the world. We forget that our elderly relatives are looked after frequently by migrants. And the newspapers that we read conveniently overlook the evidence that migrants make a very positive contribution to our economies. Now, the media matters. The media matters a great deal. And one of the reasons that we had the bizarre vote that we had earlier this year in the United Kingdom was because we've endured years of unadulterated attacks on anybody that is different, on ethnic minorities and on migrants. But you say to yourself, well, do the media really matter? Does it matter that we have all of this bile and this hatred coming out? Well, we wanted to know. So we looked, and we looked at what happened in the Sun newspaper, Rupert Murdoch's newspaper, when they changed their recommendation to vote for the Conservative Party, to voting for the Labour Party in the 1997 election. Did this make a difference? And the answer is, yes, it did. They said at the time it was the Sun what won it. Well, it was. And we were able to show that they could shift voting behavior enough to maybe not swing that election, but to swing the next election, even when they did not actually change underlying values. For anyone with a sense of history, I would suggest that what I've just said should be deeply worrying. The vote in the United Kingdom must surely remind us that we can take nothing for granted. Many of us thought that it was frankly inconceivable that so many of the British people would vote against their own interests. But they did. The author Charles Emerson has written a superb account of life in the year 1913 in 30 cities across the world. Now, of course, it's easy with the benefit of hindsight to see what happened later. But what is really striking about that book is that for almost all of those whose stories are told, the carnage of the following 4 years was equally inconceivable. I would suggest that anyone who believes in the Enlightenment values of evidence and inquiry, of tolerance and of mutual respect, and the more recent value of solidarity, cannot ignore those factors that are driving politics today. And that means that we need to understand the lives of those that are so different from our own and who see the world so differently from many of us in this audience today. So let me conclude. As someone who's concerned with the health of the population, and especially the health of the most disadvantaged, I must try to understand the impact on health of the changes that are taking place in society. And as a European researcher, and I should stress that despite the suicidal policies or lack of policies being pursued by the government of the country in which I currently live, I am a committed European. I have the benefit of an incredible natural laboratory to study these issues. The growth of precariousness is not inevitable. While wages have stagnated in the UK and Germany, they've risen in Finland and Slovakia. Skyrocketing house prices in the UK contrast with the situation here in the Netherlands, which maintained stable housing prices even during the recessions. Sweden has slowly reduced pension support, but France has increased it for some older people. There are many different responses from which we can learn. The Danish model of flexicurity, for example, characterized by market freedom in employment, compensated by generous secure benefits, a model not dissimilar from what you have here. And this creates a situation where you can have job insecurity, but relatively low labor market insecurity, with confidence that you will find another job and sufficient severance pay. Now, each country obviously has to adopt the policies that take account of its own starting conditions and what constitutionally or institutionally is possible. The Dutch health system is a good example. It's a product of history, of the starting conditions. You may not necessarily have got to where you are now if you had a blank sheet of paper. Nobody does. But the common feature of policies that protect the health of populations in the face of adversity, active labour market programmes and policies to protect people against losing people from losing their homes, is that they show ordinary people that those in power actually care. They actually care about them, and that's a very important message. But there's another reason why we should be concerned, and that's my final point. Our democratic systems are based on a social contract, and those in power, those with the power, should not use that power to breach that contract. Because if they do, we know the lessons of history, and we know that if they do, it can have consequences for us all. Dank u wel. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Thank you, Martin, for your impressive and rich lecture, largely based on own research data, also making clear that in addition to a researcher, you're also a person very much committed with the topics you are studying and the relevance of those topics for society. Thank you so much. We see you back later in the panel. As I already introduced, we will now have a reflection by Beatrice Haverkamp. She is a PhD scholar at Wageningen University with special interest in concepts of health. Beatrice, the floor is yours.
Thank you, André. So, one of the points Professor McKee has pointed out here
is that the growth of precariousness negatively affects the health of a population. And in the next 10 minutes, I will briefly reflect on the question what we should mean by the health of a population. This question matters because explication of what we exactly mean by health helps at least a bit to measure the effectiveness of public policies and to set priorities. Now, a brief look at attempts to define health illustrates that such explications are never neutral affairs. They're always marked by a particular historic or ideological background. For instance, when the World Health Organization in 1948 defined health as, quote unquote, a state of complete mental, physical, and social well-being, not merely the absence of disease or infirmity, we should situate this within the context of the post-Second World War. A time that was characterized by a spirit of rebuilding societies and by high aspirations for world peace and welfare. The constitution of the World Health Organization even literally refers to health as being, quote unquote, basic to the happiness and harmonious relations and security of all peoples. Health is thereby pictured as an ideal in itself and as a precondition for world peace. Later on, in the 70s, the Swedish philosopher Christopher Bors made a plea for a more narrow concept of health, the notion of health as absence of disease. This scientific theory of health should be seen in the light of the anti-psychiatry movement and the concerns expressed by that movement. Now, in one of the central questions that was raised by this movement was the question of if and how we could distinguish socially deviant behavior from mental illness. And Bors aimed to show that we can distinguish the two. Formulating an objective and value-free definition of disease should enable us to make a distinction between social prejudice and mental illness. And in this way, the scientific theory of health helps to prevent that something like homosexuality is perceived and treated as a psychiatric disorder. And this idea that being healthy is the opposite of being diseased characterizes the dominant understanding of health today. Recently, though, in the Netherlands, a new concept of health is proposed by Machteld Huber and other health experts, among whom André Knotnieres, as an alternative to both the World Health Organization's the demanding definition of the World Health Organization, as well as to the tendency to exclusively focus on absence of disease. This concept of health is formulated in the light of the aging of populations and medical progress, due to which living with a chronic disease has become relatively normal. Moreover, with the availability of good medicines, health apps, and high-quality care, living with a disease is not always experienced as a heavy burden on one's life. It is therefore that Huber and others argue that today, health should be seen as the ability to adapt and self-manage. And with this new concept of health, the focus shifts from medical experts to the patient's point of view. So far, I've shown that context matters for how we think about health. Now, Professor McKee's analysis faces us with another context. And this too gives rise to the question of how we should understand health in public policy. For if we have indications that a growing lack of social and economic certainties lead to all kinds of health problems, what does that mean for our understanding of health? In my view, the context of precariousness at least invites us to shift our attention. And to show how, I will look at how different concepts of health inform measures that we take to indicate the health of a population. So in practice, the complicated definition of the World Health Organization is measured in terms of life expectancy. Now, this has its rhetorical force to indicate that there is work to do in Malawi, but it has limited meaning in the context of contemporary European societies. For as Professor McKee has pointed out, conditions like job insecurity and insecurity about other living conditions These deteriorate people's health and their well-being. Now, the second scientific notion of health as absence of disease informs the measure of healthy life expectancy, meaning that the years lived in absence of disease indicate the health of a population. And this is relevant if we're interested in a fair distribution of healthcare resources. But as said, living with a chronic disease today does not necessarily imply a diminished experience of health. And it is therefore that the third concept of health as the ability to adapt and self-manage turns away from these objective measures to the experience of the individual. Now, Huber's approach works well for practices of health care, where doctors talk with their patients about how they experience and cope with their health problems. But this subjective approach seems problematic for the practice of public health, and especially in the light of precariousness. A government or a policymaker is not a physician and is thereby not in the position to talk with individuals about their health. The political question here is to what extent a government should be concerned with subjective experiences when it comes to the health of citizens. The risk with an exclusive focus on the individual is that it distracts from what seems to be a more proper concern for public health, namely a concern with the circumstances that, as Professor McKee has shown, determine people's health, but also enable and disable people to cope with their health problems. So today in Europe, the objective measures of life expectancy and healthy life expectancy do not provide the most relevant keystones for public policy. And subjective measures are good for healthcare practices, but seem problematic or less appropriate for the practice of public health. Instead, if we accept Professor McKee's analysis of precariousness, that precariousness marks many of our societies today, the pressing question for public health is how to bring about a shift in focus. And that is a shift from the individual to that individual's social and economic circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you, Beatrice. That was brilliant. You made very good connections, impressive connections between concepts of health and the concept of precariousness. And you also gave some challenges for future exploration. Thank you so much. Now I would like to invite the panel members, the chair, Godfried Engbersen, Ingrid van Engelshoven, Jan-Antonie Bruin, and again, Maarten McKee to the floor.
Dear guest, my name is Godfried Engbersen. Godfried Engbersen is a little bit difficult, you know, to express in English. I have the honor and the privilege to moderate a little debate based on the lecture and inspired by the lecture of Maarten McKee. And for that debate, we have two very distinguished guests, speakers, debaters, and I'd like to introduce them to you. First of all, Ingrid van Engelshoven. She is a city administrator of The Hague since 2010, and her portfolio shows a number of responsibilities: knowledge economy, international affairs, youth and education. She has been party chairwoman of D66, which is a social liberal party, in the period 2007 and 2013, and she will become a member of the Dutch parliament after the upcoming election, because she's very high on the electoral list. And she will respond to McKee from a big city perspective. Secondly, Jan-Antonie Bruin, a professor of immune pathology at the Academic Medical Center of the University of Leiden. He's a senator of the VVD, which is a conservative liberal party, partly a social liberal party in one. And he is an expert on education and public health. And he was, and I think that's a true accomplishment, he was a threefold chairman of the committee writing the electoral program of the VVD in 2010, 12, and 16. And he will respond to McKee from a more, not from a nationalistic, but from a more country perspective. There are short responses. They will give a short response. They will be in English, and afterwards you'll have a debate in Dutch. So we have to combine, we will play with different languages. It's also, I think, an indicator of resilience. And I would like to give the floor to Ingrid van Engelshoven.
Well, thank you. And I thank the Scientific Council for giving me the floor for this, for brief reflection on Professor McKee's provocative contribution today. And I appreciate Professor McKee pointing out a couple of difficulties in modern-day society, and especially him stressing some social aspects like mental health. Because in the end, isn't that what all public policies should be about? The well-being of us all. Work should be more than earning your paycheck. It should be also about personal development, social relations, and self-respect. And Professor McKee, if one of your key messages is that the political discourse should be more about people and their well-being, I totally agree. But other than you, I think I say this with optimism, because when we look back through history, we see that mankind has made great progress. Poverty declined, life expectancy more than doubled last century, and then the Dutch people are still the happiest ones in the world. And whatever some politicians are trying to make us believe, our healthcare system is still one of the best and most accessible in the world. Income inequality has hardly risen in the Netherlands, and there's still great consensus that we should keep it that way. And let us be clear, uncertainty and change are not new. The current degree and pace may differ a lot, but they have always been there, uncertainty and change. But I think the big difference is that now we no longer trust that all this change will lead to improvement. And what questions does this raise for politics and government, and from my own perspective, for city administration? I think there's one thing we shouldn't do, and that is that act as if we can go back to the past. If we just leave the EU, no longer make trade treaties, and close our borders, everything will get better. That's what populists say, and I don't agree. It won't make our life better, and as a woman, I can say there isn't much reason to look too long back for the past. I would like to go into three things that could help us face the challenges. The first thing, invest in people on a more permanent basis. Start at an early age, as early as possible, and make sure that people can keep on learning throughout their lives. Make this an individual right. And make sure that education is broad and comprehensive. Of course, cognitive subjects matter, but we should keep education broad. We really need to invest in people's ability to adapt, to deal with changes, to reflect, and to continue to work on their own development. And we also need to invest in the ability for people to live a healthy life. In short, we have to learn people to be resilient. Secondly, we should give people a solid footing, and especially on the labor market. There is, Professor McKee touched upon that, and I think we should give people who need that the outlook to a permanent contract. And to make that possible, we need to reform the labor market in the Netherlands. And in the presentation of Professor McKee, I saw an image of Drees, and in your words, I heard a great love for the traditional welfare state built up after World War II. And That's what we hear in the Netherlands sometimes from the conservative left, the existing welfare state as an untouchable sanctuary. But didn't it leave people passive, and did it make their dependent, and did it really help them to become resilient? And I think we should rethink the values of a new welfare state. Then from a city perspective, much of what people see as threat to their own security comes down from institutions far away, the EU, trade deals, the national government. And as an administrator in a major city, you soon learn that people's well-being is often largely shaped by their own living environment, the block you live in, your street, your neighborhood. And this means that we should keep investing in the quality of that living environment, good housing, clean streets, clean air, and safety in the neighborhood. And it's precisely on a neighborhood level that we can all also give people more influence and control, enabling them to take control of their own lives, neighborhood budgets, and say about how to invest in public spaces. And when I come into these neighborhoods, I see a great deal of energy and enthusiasm by a lot of people to do this. But there's still a lot to be done to make participation more inclusive. Will this solve everything? Of course not. We cannot avoid the fact that major changes that come as a shock can lead to problems for people and their families. And in typically middle-class neighborhoods, health problems increased during the financial crisis. We saw that. Unemployment and debt were devastating for many families. And decentralization in the social domain helps us to tackle these issues cohesively. Health problems can often be resolved more efficiently by debt support than by doctors. And we need to acknowledge that there will always be groups of people who cannot find their way on the labor market unaided. Those unfit for work, people with few or no qualifications, people who are illiterate, those who are socially less able, we need to be prepared to provide them with a sort of short or long-term support in finding their place in society. And I think these are some of the major challenges we face for the coming period. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your response, Jan Anthony Bruin. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Professor McKee, for that eloquent keynote speech on the growth of precariousness and why it matters for health. I was asked to briefly reflect on it from our national point of view. The international crisis that you discussed also hit our economy here in the Netherlands. In the past few years, steps have been taken to ensure that our country emerged strong from that crisis. And successfully so. Recent reports show that unemployment in our country is dropping faster than any time in the past 10 years. We now have more than 66,000 more jobs than before the Lehman crisis in 2008. The highest increase has been in both temporary and permanent jobs, while self-employment has decreased. Consumer confidence has also risen in recent months and is currently at its highest level in 9 years. In healthcare, the increase in spending has been slowed through lower prices and reduced volume growth, thanks to agreements with family doctors, hospitals, the mental health care sector, and health insurance companies. Only last month, international researchers ranked the Netherlands top internationally with regards to access to all sorts of healthcare independent of socio-economic status. However, leaving the economic and financial crisis behind us does not imply that all people already feel and experience a resurrecting sense of security, or a reduction of precariousness, if you wish. We want everyone to feel that the quality of life is truly improving and that we are building a better country with a strong future. So there is work to do in the coming years. Work to restore security for all, reaffirming our way of living and securing our freedoms. Investing at least 1 billion euros extra in security in our streets and in our national defense systems. Dealing in a convincing, justful, and sustainable way with the migration challenge, where true compassion demands true hope. Increasing downward pressure on housing prices by finding shortage through stimulation of construction activities and refocusing government interference on the social sector. The number of elderly in our population will continue to rise in the coming years, and many of them will thankfully enjoy good health for many years to come. But there's also a group of people who live with chronic disease, and that means demand for care is on the rise. Many people in the Netherlands worry whether adequate care will be available by the time they need it, whether they'll be able to pay for it, whether a suitable facility will be available to care for their elderly patients. Quality of care will demand further development of quality, transparency, e-health, and outcome-based funding. Accessibility of care will demand a continued firm grip on the rising cost of it and an extra investment of 100 million euros in care for the most needy, including those in inner cities and neighborhoods. We will also have to guard solidarity in care, now that the young and the higher educated pay increasingly and already about half the cost of care of the elderly and the lower educated. Coping with precariousness also means excellent education for all. Further internationalization and digitalization of education will allow for more individually adapted curricula in all educational sectors and also novel ways of international aid for developing countries. Transition to lifelong learning is already taking place, and the illiterate of the 21st century will not be those who cannot read and write, but those who cannot learn, unlearn, and relearn, as Toffler put it. Investing in this direction is of utmost importance in the fight against précarité de l'emploi et de travail. McKeel rightfully stressed the great social and health importance of job security. People worry about not being able to find permanent work and having to move from one job to another, or needing even to have several jobs to make ends meet. Therefore, we will need to improve everyone's chances of finding permanent work. To this end, it must be made easier and less expensive for employers to offer permanent jobs. As mentioned only last week by investigators from Utrecht University, economic growth does more for the unemployed in our country than all other government measures taken together. This includes job seekers of over 50 years of age, members of the so-called middle class, and those in our inner cities where a concentration of precariousness takes place. Thus, restoring job security in the Netherlands will demand stimulating economic growth by investing at least 10 billion euros in infrastructure, tax relief, diminishing cost of labor, and innovation and research. Job security will also demand revising the laws and regulations governing our labor market. According to the OECD, the Netherlands is marked with one of the strongest employment protection laws for workers with job tenure. In particular, they noted that prior approval from both the Public Employment Service and the Civil Court is counterproductive. As a reaction to their observation that overly strict regulation leads to poor labor market outcomes, different European institutions have encouraged their member states, and in particular our country, to revisit the strictness of their employment protection systems. The OECD job study advised to loosen mandatory restrictions on dismissals in countries where current provisions appear to seriously hinder economic restructuring and the hiring chances of those seeking a job. The European Commission and the International Labour Office have made similar recommendations. Flexible contractual arrangements combined with social security, or flexicurity as they call it in Denmark, which you already alluded to. In sum, now that the financial and economic crisis has been dealt with in our country and structural reforms are in place, precariousness with respect to our way of living dictates the political agenda for the coming years, also in our country. Safety, education, jobs, housing and healthcare as basic factors allowing for adaptivity. It will demand a carefully calibrated role for government and has rightfully been the subject of today's keynote speech by Professor McKee. Thank you.
Thank you. Heel veel dank voor uw reactie. Ik ga naar mevrouw van Engelshoven. Het begrip precariousness, hoe vertaalt u dat in het Nederlands?
Ja, ik denk dat je het, als je het goed op het netvlies wil krijgen, het vooral een gezicht moet geven. En het gaat voor mij om, het zijn de mensen die je gewoon ook tegenkomt in de stad. Het is die vrouw uit Leids van Ypenburgen, Vieslenkswijk van Den Haag. Die daar ooit met haar echtgenoot is gaan wonen in het huis wat ze net konden betalen. Zij werd huisvrouw. Er kwam een echtscheiding, inkomen viel weg. En zo'n vrouw komt terecht in een andere wijk, in sociale huisvesting, met kinderen, onzeker of haar man de alimentatie gaat betalen, verliest haar sociale netwerk en werkt inderdaad, omdat ze een grote afstand had tot de arbeidsmarkt, een paar kleine baantjes bij elkaar.
Dus, ik geef ook een hele brede omschrijving van het begrip precariousness.
Dus het leven van zo iemand wordt, kan in een korte periode op heel veel terreinen onzeker worden. En volgens mij is dat de belangrijkste definitie. Of het nou gaat om werk, om gezondheid, om je sociale omgeving. Het is zoveel onzekerheid bij elkaar dat eigenlijk de vaste bodem onder je leven verdwijnt.
En als we nu naar de stad Den Haag kijken, we hebben net een slide gezien over de, zeg maar, de verspreiding van voedselbanken in Engeland. Ik heb gisteren dus bekeken en ik zie dat er 14, 15 uitzetpunten zijn voor de voedselbank in Den Haag. Zien we nou een groei van precariousness ook in Den Haag? Want u schetst een relatief zonnig beeld van de stad Den Haag. Maar zien we ook een meer grimmig gezicht?
Zeker. 20%, ik ben verantwoordelijk voor jeugd, 20% van de kinderen in Den Haag groeit op in armoede. Dat is een ongelooflijk groot aantal. En dat zegt ook iets over het aantal gezinnen wat in armoede leeft. En als je kijkt naar wie maakt nou gebruik van de voedselbanken, dan zie ik ook wel twee categorieën waar grote problemen liggen. En dat is mensen met schulden. Heel veel mensen hebben korter of langere termijn last van schulden. En daarmee ook vaak gezondheidsklachten. En ik denk dat het heel belangrijk is, en dat is een belangrijke maatregel ook van, geef die mensen ook gewoon een soort van pauze waarin ze even hun leven op orde kunnen krijgen. Maar
ik ga proberen de microfoon van die over te nemen.
Ja, en de laatste is dat zijn ook de het zijn mensen met schulden. Maar het zijn ook vaak de mensen die ongeletterd zijn. En dat maakt ook vaak financieel ongeletterd. En die daardoor dus in grote problemen komen. En dus ook langdurig afhankelijk zijn van een uitkering. En daar moet je dus iets extra's voor doen om die weer toegang te geven tot de arbeidsmarkt.
Dank u wel. Dezelfde vraag voor Jan Anthony. Wat is precariousness in Nederland? Ook u geeft een relatief zonnig beeld van de grote hervormingen hebben plaatsgevonden. Wat ziet u nou vanuit een nationaal perspectief als je dit begrip introduceert in Nederland?
Nou, vanuit mijn eigen ervaring. Toen wij in 2010, was ik voor het eerst betrokken bij een landelijk verkiezingsprogramma. Toen zijn we jaarlang het hele land doorgegaan en gevraagd aan mensen, waar zit nou uw zorg? Waar zit uw spanning? Waar zit uw onzekerheid? En toen was het heel duidelijk dat overal in het land, niet alleen in binnensteden, maar ook in bijvoorbeeld krimpgebieden en elders in Nederland, het ging om de economische crisis. Het ging om het verlies van een baan. Het ging om werkgelegenheid, maar ook koopkracht. De grote staatsschuld die we hadden. We zaten toen ook in een economische crisis. Als je nu door het land gaat, afgelopen jaar hebben we dat weer mogen doen. Dat hebben overigens alle partijen ook gedaan, hè? En je vraagt aan mensen in kroegjes en op scholen en waar je ook maar komt. Overigens een hele mooie ervaring. Kan u allemaal aanraden als u ooit bij een programma betrokken mag zijn. Dat is echt fraai. Dan krijg je een totaal ander beeld. En dat zou ik eigenlijk een precariousness shift willen noemen. Het gaat namelijk niet meer over de dingen waar ik het net over had. Maar het gaat wel over andere dingen. En dan gaat het over onze normen en waarden in dit land. Blijft Nederland Nederland? Het gaat over onze veiligheid. Veiligheid op straat. Kan ik mijn kind veilig over straat laten lopen naar school? De veiligheid natuurlijk ook in internationaal verband. Het gaat verder over de houdbaarheid van onze zorg. Is er straks nog wel zorg voor mijn minder jonge vader die hier overigens voor in de zaal zit. Gelukkig nog heel gezond. Daar zitten nu de zorgen van de mensen. En interessant genoeg, je zou het dus kunnen vertalen met stress of onzekerheid. En in mijn vak de immunopathologie is ook aangetoond dat chronische stress ook daadwerkelijk echt tot ziekte leidt. Het leidt tot hart- en vaatziekten. Het leidt tot onderdrukking van je afweersysteem. Dus die chronische spanning, die onzekerheid die mensen voelen, die precariousness, is ook echt in medische zin iets wat je moet bestrijden.
Mag ik er nog een vraag aan toevoegen? U citeerde net de OECD, maar dat is ook een andere OECD-studie die laat zien dat Nederland een van de meest flexibele arbeidsmarkten kent van West-Europa. 1 op de 5 mensen heeft een flexibel arbeidscontract. We hebben 1 miljoen ZZP'ers. Is dat ook niet een bron van zorg? Dus vraag 1. 2, we hebben net een slide gezien van jonge doktoren.
Mag ik die eerst beantwoorden? Ik heb een heel slecht geheugen.
Ja.
Oké, ik zal die doktoren dan meteen meenemen. Die passen
mijn vraag is, rekent u ook de Nederlandse jonge doktoren tot het precariaat? Ja. Of mensen in een precaire positie?
De eerste vraag, ik denk dat bij mensen met een tijdelijke baan, je een onderscheid moet maken tussen mensen die dat graag willen en mensen die dat tegen hun zin hebben, die liever een vaste baan zouden willen.
Het merendeel wil een vaste baan.
Ja, inderdaad. Er zijn dus te veel tijdelijke banen, te weinig vaste banen. In de afgelopen periode hebben we geprobeerd om daar iets aan te doen door tijdelijke banen voor een deel te verbieden. We hebben bijvoorbeeld het maximum aantal tijdelijke aanstellingen teruggebracht van 3 naar 2. U heeft vandaag in de krant kunnen lezen, en ook heel vaak al in de afgelopen weken, dat dat in ieder geval niet werkt. Wat we misschien wel moeten doen, en waar de meerderheid van de mensen ook wel over eens lijkt te zijn, is het aantrekkelijker maken en meer mogelijk maken voor werkgevers om permanente banen aan te bieden. Dus niet het verbieden van tijdelijke banen, maar het mogelijk maken van het aanbieden van een permanente baan. En dat heeft te maken met ontslag.
Hoe gaan we dat doen?
Dat heeft te maken met bijvoorbeeld ontslagrecht. Dat heeft te maken met goede aansluiting onderwijs-arbeidsmarkt. Dat heeft ook te maken met de kosten van arbeid, die ontzettend hoog zijn op dit moment in Nederland. En macro-economisch heeft het vooral te maken met beschikbaarheid van banen en dus economische groei. Daarom heb ik net ook gezegd, we zijn nu wel uit een economische crisis, maar mensen voelen het nog niet, want die werkgelegenheid is nog niet aangetrokken. En de komende 4 jaar zal er dus heel hard gewerkt moeten worden om die werkgelegenheid ook daadwerkelijk op gang te krijgen. Trouwens, altijd het laatste wagonnetje wat gaat rijden. En dan de dokters.
En de dokters, precies, ja.
Ja, die dokters, die jonge dokters, daar zit ik dan zelf als oudere dokter iedere dag tussen.
Ja.
En de dokters hebben...
En die geeft ze een flexibel contract natuurlijk.
Nou, wij geven ze bij voorkeur een permanent contract. Ja. Maar dan moeten de kosten van die permanente arbeid niet te hoog zijn. En dan moet het ontslagrecht versoepeld worden.
Ja.
En dan moet de economische groei zo sterk zijn dat we ook meer gezondheidszorg eruit kunnen betalen. Dus dan komen we weer terug bij het vorige punt. Maar ja, ik dacht je over de dokters wel praten.
Ja.
De dokters hebben het inderdaad ontzettend druk. Je kan zelfs wel zeggen dat veel dokters tegen het overbelasten aanlopen. Dan hebben we het dus over de gezondheidszorg. Het probleem van de zorg is dat het eigenlijk een economische sector is waar de vraag eigenlijk onbeperkt is. Alles wat wij verzinnen, alles wat wij aanbieden en innoveren, dat wil iemand die ziek is ook hebben, ikzelf ook. Daar is in de afgelopen periode wel iets aan gedaan, aan die ongebreidelde groei van de kosten van de zorg, door bijvoorbeeld afspraken te maken met het veld en ook een aantal andere maatregelen. Ik denk dat we in de komende periode daar, en zeker komende generaties, ook weer voor een enorme uitdaging staan. Er kan gewoon veel meer dan wat we kunnen betalen. Dus behalve het continueren van maatregelen die al genomen zijn, zullen we het ook echt moeten hebben over, moet alles nou wat kan in de zorg?
Ja.
We zullen keuzes moeten maken.
Ja.
Anders wordt het straks een kostenplaatje van 40% van ons nationaal product, in plaats van nu 15% die het al is. 15% van uw inkomen gaat al naar de gezondheidszorg.
Dank u wel. Mr. McKee, I think that we're listening to the debate. I think you didn't understand a word. I have the feeling. so let me try to translate it to you. But I think I want to raise one question. And so listening to the debate, there are two lines. One line says we have to increase the capabilities of people to adapt, to be flexible in a new world, to cope with diseases, to cope with a more uncertain labor market, on the one hand. But the other hand, and I think that was your plea, to innovate and recalibrate institutions. So to create a labor market that provides more secure jobs, to create new kinds of policies to support people. And what are these, should we go back to the old welfare state of the past? What kind of new social policy are necessary to support those flexible individuals?
Well, you're absolutely right that, of course, we don't have the certainty. We don't have the certainties of the past, and we don't have the heavy manufacturing industry, the things that really we look from the middle of the 19th century onwards took us through into the 1950s. That's gone. So we do need a degree of flexibility, but we do have good evidence. And in a longer version of the talk, before I cut it down to the 45 minutes, I was going to say something about our work on active labour market programmes. There is quite good evidence from across Europe that even where people are losing their jobs, if there are systems in place and by active labour market programmes, these are programmes that provide training and retraining. They provide information on employment. They provide particular support for disabled people, the people that you mentioned. And that can completely break the link between job losses and suicide, both in our historic work looking at the period from the 1980s onwards and in the current financial crisis.
That's a rather new phenomenon, because you showed this France figures, but you also have this kind of figures for the UK. Increase in suicide rates related to work issues.
Well, we don't know what's happening with suicides related to work in the UK because we don't collect the data. Okay. In France, it clearly is an issue, and we've got current ongoing research which is looking at that across Europe. But the idea of active labour market programmes are actually being taken up by civil servants in the UK because of the evidence. What we've also shown is that where they are strong, and there are measures, OECD do collect data that allow us to generate a score for different OECD countries. And we find that when we look at the countries that do have them particularly well developed, they are capable of protecting people who are in poor health, providing the crisis is not extreme. Yeah. And what we were able to show was that over the last 20 years or so, during the normal economic fluctuations, including recessions and so on, they can provide a considerable degree of protection. But during the financial, the 2008 crisis in the countries that were worst affected, then they're not sufficient. You need something more than that. Okay. But I think what they do is they do give people hope, and they're coupled with the ability to encourage people to take risks, because we do want risk-taking entrepreneurs. We don't want people to be in jobs where they know that no matter how badly they perform, you can never get rid of them. That doesn't help anybody. We need to have a mechanism for managing performance. We need to have a mechanism to ensure that we are encouraging those people who are the most productive. But it has to be balanced. And if people know that if they take a risk once, that basically is the end of it's the end for them, there's no real prospect of getting out of that, then you have a problem. It's getting those two in balance, which I think is what you were saying. I don't have any disagreement with that, but we just need to find ways of doing that. And there are ways that we can do that. I think there's a lot that we can learn. And, you know, the Netherlands is in a much better position than in many other European countries. You may have problems, but I have to say, looked at from across the other side of the channel, my God, I wish we had your problems.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. I think that now it's time the floor is for the audience. Who wants to raise a question, make a comment? Would be nice, I think, to mention your name and your professional background. I suggest that we do it in English because we have a problem with the translation. Don't I? Yeah. Please stand up. They will bring the microphone to you.
My name is Bart van Riel of Hoek Hoon. I'm an IT and social architect. My question is, and what I would like to propose, to introduce a kind of new paradigm related to jobs and work. Jobs are centralized to organizations, and where's less flexibility. The second thing, and work is about security, what you do. When you think about self-organization, what is more possible with internet and stuff like that, I think we have, and self-investment, crowdfund, we can self-organize our own work and meanwhile be more flexible in expressing ourselves and give our life our own meaning.
Okay.
So I wonder how you think about this way of looking
at this is a question.
Work versus job. Jobs.
Question for Mr. McKee?
Yes. Thank you.
I don't have a problem with that in principle, but there's a key issue that we haven't mentioned so far, and that's the asymmetry of power. And one of the issues that runs all the way through this is who has the power? Because if you are a brilliant internet genius with lots of entrepreneurial skills, you have the power to control your own work and you don't need a job. But there are many people who don't have that power, and in particular, people with lower, not just people with lower levels of skills. In fact, the precarious group that I was talking about, this includes people who have very high levels of skills and don't have and still face problems. So an issue that we could have talked about today is power and health and the asymmetry of power, because in many ways the power of ordinary people has been eroded, particularly through the reduction in the power of trade unions. I think that's had an enormous impact across Europe. It's certainly had an impact in the United States, and we have seen the way in which the loss of that collective bargaining which redressed the power in the workplace has disadvantaged many groups, particularly with the evidence that trade unions actually benefit everybody and not just their own members. So power is at the heart of all of this. If you have the power, then having a work but no job is fine. If you don't have the power, I think jobs and the security that go with that are much more important.
Okay, thank you. Would you like to add something to that?
Yes, and I think going from job security to work security, I think, is the shift we have to make. And it means a lot in making people more adaptive, more self-reliant, and more resilient. It asks a lot about education and making education more, giving people more entrepreneurial skills. I don't agree with Professor McKee when it comes to the role of trade unions, because they did good things, and having collective arrangements are a good thing, but not for everything. And I think an important criticism from my side on the Dutch labor unions is that they didn't invest in lifelong learning of Dutch laborers. They put a lot of the money in funds and didn't give it. And didn't give people access to those funds to invest in themselves, to develop themselves. And that's why we have to make a shift to make it not a collective right, but an individual right.
Okay, thank you. I have a second question here. Please, is there a microphone for this gentleman?
My name is Frank Pot from Radboud University in Nijmegen. Well, I was thinking of additional information about on the level of work organizations. We have been told that long-term stress and uncertainty is related to cardiovascular diseases. And in our work and organization science, we know for 40 years already that this is the case on job level. When people have jobs with high demands and they have very low decision latitude or job control, this combination is really, you can predict cardiovascular diseases. There's a lot of research that confirms this relationship. So we can also start to make people resilient in the workplace by creating active jobs with a good balance between job demands and job control. And this demands, of course, a management regime of participation and trust instead of the management regime of command and control as we see it now in most companies.
Okay, thank you. I think it's more a comment, but maybe one of you want to reflect upon that?
Well, and clearly you're absolutely right, and there's a wealth of material of research from Theorel and Karasek and Sigrist and others who've looked at this, and we're clearly seeing that in the situation in France with the workplace suicides. I'm just a bit cautious about the word resilience, and I think we need to be clear about what we mean by that, because there is a tendency arising where we could, if we're not careful, blame people who have illnesses or commit suicide for their lack of resilience, as if it's part of their character that is lacking and it's their responsibility to become more resilient, whenever they're often in circumstances that in fact would overwhelm the resilience of anyone. And so just a little bit of care. But I think what you're saying is that we need to provide people with jobs that are actually fulfilling. And this is where we come back to the power, and particularly with information technology. When we have warehouses in the UK run by Amazon and others, and I should say Amazon companies that pay virtually no tax in the UK whatsoever. I mean, these are companies that can put nothing back into society, and where they have GPS devices attached to people, and they're timed. They have only a few seconds to go to the bathroom. They need to make sure they fulfill all the orders. We have a real problem too with the casualization of delivery drivers coming up to Christmas, where there's a concern about the safety on the roads because people are so tired they're falling asleep at the wheel. We had a tram that derailed in London recently, where it was quite clear that the driver was on one of these contracts where they had very irregular hours. So people are actually dying as a consequence of this, and not just the workers, the people that they're transporting to. So it comes back to the point about who has the power. If people do need to have jobs where they get more than money, they need fulfillment. Otherwise, people will die, and as I say, not just the workers.
Okay, thank you.
My name is Joel Mackenbach, Erasmus Medical Center. Martin, you briefly mentioned the fact that people sometimes seem to vote not in their own interests. And that reminded me of an article in The Economist of last week, which shows that the highest number of voters for Donald Trump is in areas where mortality is highest, despite the fact that Donald Trump wants to abolish Obamacare, which will possibly raise mortality even further. So is it true that people don't regularly vote in their own interests, and why? Is it not too difficult to vote in your own interest? All parties claim that they will act in your interest.
I suggest that all three speakers try to answer this question.
I'm happy to start, but somebody else might like to start first.
Yes, first, please.
Well, I actually did have that slide, and I was going to use it, but I had too many slides, so I didn't. And I think that's right, because, in fact, that's not the only situation where we have seen that poor health relates to voting behaviour. People are left behind. There are two books by Thomas Franks, one called What's the Matter with Kansas, and the other, Pity the Billionaire, that looks in detail at the way in which basically, the poor white American population consistently votes against its own interests. If we look at what will happen with the election of Donald Trump, there will be tax cuts, but there will be tax cuts for people like Donald Trump. They will not necessarily be tax cuts for the people who voted for him. And in terms of the impact on, well, we also know that voting for Trump was much more common among the elderly. And one of the policies that the Republicans are pursuing is the dismantling of Medicare, which will have massive implications for them. So they are very clearly voting against their own interests. We had the situation, and you know, I hesitate to go back to it because many of us are still in a state of bereavement over the ludicrous decision that we had. But within 24 hours of the vote to leave the EU, you had the county councils in Cornwall sending messages to Westminster to say, well, we will, of course, continue to get the money we used to get from the EU, won't we? The answer, of course, was no, you won't. The fishermen, who all 92% of them voted to leave, being told, no, it's not what you think. So I think there's so much to look at on the Brexit debate. I mean, the one good thing I should say just for the audience is that you will have realised that the British government is currently doing its best to emulate Zimbabwe as being a failed state. And given its level of capacity at the minute, I think the prospect of us actually leaving the EU is pretty remote, because we can't actually do anything at the minute. And nobody knows what's going on. Or maybe you do, because other people seem to know much more than we do.
Thank you.
But yes.
Yes, and I would also like to, to ask you, is it really against their own interest? Because you could argue that some people, they felt left alone and didn't trust the traditional parties.
Well, I think that's the key, and it's about trust. It's also in the question raised earlier in job control is also a matter about trust. Employers not trusting their employees and putting up too much rules. It's people voting against their own interest is because they distrust national government, EU, whatever institution. And I think we should analyze how did it come so far. And I think there are two key elements, and it's government put too little trust in their citizens. And that's why I believe, and you see it, and we have to build up again from, start small from a local level, trust people in getting grips on their own environment without leaving them alone. So supporting them where it's necessary, but giving them some trust. If you want trust as a government or as politics, you should give some trust. And that's where the balance went the wrong way. And there's, of course, a lot to be said about broken promises. Well, I think politicians should be more careful in promising, promises to the sky, and then where the sky is the limit, and then breaking them, say sorry, and go over to the order of the day. That's not what we can keep on doing.
Thank you. Thank you. The final word is for Jan-Anthony Bruin.
Well, you seem to have found a difference between our parties, finally. You were looking for that, I know, because my party is against referenda. If you look at democracy, this discussion goes back to Plato and Socrates, and we can have that whole discussion again, but in its purest form, democracy is the voice of the people. And yes, we should trust them, but also when they vote, even if some of us judge that that's against their own interest. Another thing is, should you have referenda outside of your usual voting system? It's a discussion. Maybe on the long run, the answer is good education. And if I look around me at young generation, young people in our hospital who are studying, and young doctors, they are very well aware that they need entrepreneurship, that they need to take those risks, that they need to keep living, keep learning their whole life. That's a completely different way of looking at knowledge, which has an incredibly strong and fast turnover these days. So our initial learning is much more learning to learn these days, and what these young generations do, and for them it's already normal, they keep learning and relearning their whole life. That may even be the answer against voting in a way that some of us judge is against your own interests. It's on the edge, that discussion. But referenda, no.
Okay. Thank you. Allow me to conclude by highlighting that this topic of precariousness, I think, is at the heart or relatively central to a lot of projects nowadays within the WRR, a project on health and inequalities, a project on the future of work and the growth of precarious work. There is a project on social cleavages, on social divisions in society between educational groups and between migrants and non-migrants, and also is a project on the insecurity of the middle class. We hope to publish some work in the new year. Now I would like to thank the contributors, and I would give the floor again to the chairman, André Knotnier. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Godfried. Thank you very much. Allow me some brief observations. I think it has been made clear that precariousness is really a topic, not only internationally, but also in the Netherlands. We should be sharp on that. It also has been made clear that it is an important determinant, not only of societal developments that might be of concern, but also a determinant of subjective and objective health outcomes. And in addition, it has been made clear that it is not an inevitable development. There are ways based on, for example, international comparison, but also comparing local policies, that there are very, very good, let's say, opportunities to move on and to improve. It has been made clear that it is really a challenge for the coming years. And probably we'll also some of this back in the discussions around our elections. It is, I think, a very important challenge for us as a council, as you said, Gottfried. You mentioned maybe four or five projects that are really in the heart of the matter, and that's really our task as a council, to feed the debate, also to enhance the opportunities to really move on and to present good material, good recommendations to politicians, as we have seen, who have already not only recognized the problem, but accepted responsibility to take it up. So, thanks to all of you. Thanks to, especially, of course, Beatrice Haverkamp. Thank you so much. Ingrid van Engelshoven. So, Ingrid van Engelshoven. Jan Anthony Bruin. Gottfried Engbersen. And last but not least, Martin McKee. Thank you so much.